get the memos on what's coming to town, what the attendance is going to be. We always check in with Las Vegas Visitors and Convention Authority, so shout out to them. They were the same ones that came up with the mantra of what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, but now they've changed that.
That's right.
It's a new slogan. What's the new slogan?
It's what happens in Vegas happens only in Vegas.
Only Vegas, yes. I like
hashtag
that.
Hashtag only Vegas.
Only Vegas. Vegas. Okay, so remember that hashtag, guys. And also be sure that while you're tuning in that you are sharing. Share, share, share. Sharing is caring. And you could also call in to us tonight. It's 702-608-3259. Join the chat. Yeah, we're here. We're in the building. I'm just excited. This is one thing that I'm really excited about with you that I was almost low-key jealous about because I'm a Raiders fan.
Okay.
You had a lot of implementation with that happening with the stadium coming, and you were there for the official name change to the Las Vegas Raiders when they had that ceremony. Were you there for that?
I was there for the groundbreaking.
For the groundbreaking, okay.
I was there for the groundbreaking and a couple other things.
Yeah. And you had, I saw a picture of you, I think, on social media where you had the helmet, the worker's hat, the construction hat on with the Raiders.
Yep.
I was like, oh my God, Ken, I need that. I need that construction hat.
Yeah, that was the topping off ceremony where they put the final symbolic beam in place for the stadium. So yes, a few major milestones along the way.
Yeah, like talk about it, because are you now going to become a Raiders fan with us, or
Well,
everyone will know I've been a Raiders fan since the mid 70s. Actually the early 70s. Oh, long before then.
Long before Tim
We're
Brown.
Talking like Fred Biletnikoff, Kenny Stabler.
Oh yes.
Yeah, Jack Tatum. I'm trying to think of some of the kicker.
Definitely not Marquette King, because he's with XFL. Guy, but
no, but yeah, I've been a Raiders fan since I'd say 73, 74.
Wow, awesome. And see, I didn't get into it until I was into the days of Bo Jackson, when you had the
Marcus Allen,
Howie Long.
Yep.
Yeah. Art Shell was the coach. Yep. You know, so I kind of grew up on that development. But how do you feel about the team coming here?
Very excited. Very, very excited. I mean, obviously, I have a official professional position to pay attention to, sitting on the Stadium Authority Board. But I will definitely say, as a fan and a 30-year resident of this area, would have never thought that we'd have an NFL team here. So I'm just ecstatic that it's the Raiders coming to town.
Yeah, I mean, I would have never thought that either. And at first, I was kind of in protest against it, because I wanted them to go back to L.A. And I wanted the Chargers to come here. Because I was like, the enemy can come here.
Oh, she's the enemy.
No. I wanted the enemy to come here and us go to L.A. Because it gave us a chance to get out of town, and it was closer again. Like, you had
that's
that.
True. That's
but
true.
Now that I'm seeing this stadium come up and how amazing it is.
It's
and
a
the
nice
amenities,
facility.
Yes, and the amenities that it's going to have.
Yes.
And you can probably give us some insight on some of the things that we didn't know that's coming, like the retractable rooftop is a given, but what else is there showing?
Well, actually, the roof isn't retractable, but what is retractable is the, think of a tray with grass in it. There'll be a retractable field with natural grass or real grass.
I was reading that too, because they were talking about possibly hosting a soccer tournament in that stadium, and they were saying that the grass would be retractable to turf to regular grass.
Correct.
And that kind of thing.
Correct.
Wow.
No, yeah. it's an engineering marvel. I mean, I'm a civil engineer myself. And so to me, watching some of the features of the stadium, paying attention to them, engineering marvel, some of the things that are going in there. But it's first class, world class equipment and technology that's going
into
the stadium.
And it looks amazing.
It does.
Yes, it
like
does.
Anybody, and even whether you're a Raider fan, whether you're a Vegas, you know, local or not, I mean, people that come here, they're just driving by, they get in their Uber or the taxi from the airport, and like, whoa, what's
yep.
that?
Taking pictures,
oh, yeah.
filming it, video. And that's one thing I'll mention, is eventually they will be doing stadium tours. Hopefully it's going to rival with happens in Jerry Stadium.
Yeah,
we're not going to talk about that.
Right, of course.
I'm an anti-Dallas
thank
Cowboy
you.
Fan.
Thank you,
my brother. Thank you.
So yeah, we're going to celebrate our stadium.
And I have a question about the roof, because a lot of people think it's a retractable roof.
That's what
roof.
I thought too. That's what
and people say that all the time. What is the roof exactly?
It's not a retractable roof, but it is a special substance that is designed to, on the one hand, provide enough shade to keep the heat out, especially in the heat of the extreme heat of summer, but at the same time, it will still allow light, enough light in the stadium to give you a good natural light field along with the rest.
So
of
it's not going
to
be like when we were kids with the magnifying glass burning the ants.
No.
All right.
That would be tough.
So I have to ask too, are you going to get one of the legacy bricks or anything like that? Is there any kind of sentimental memento you're going to leave with the stadium?
I don't know if I'll get a brick or not, but I will tell you that I've been blessed to get a ceremonial shovel from the groundbreaking.
Oh, nice.
In addition to that, when we were at the topping off ceremony, I was able to sign a few things, and then I actually got a ceremonial beam. It's not the real beam, but there have been some things like
well,
that along
not.
The way that I
we might need those beams in the stadium.
That's right.
You
want them to stay in the stadium.
Right, exactly. You don't want, no, we don't want that. But we're long overdue, well deserved. I mean, we were playing in Alameda on a baseball field, sharing that with the Oakland A's. True. I mean, you'd see the baseball diamond on the football field, and it's just ridiculous. So it's kind of refreshing, and I'm very excited that we actually
have our own home.
What else can you tell me? Let's just backtrack as far as the rumors of it coming,
okay,
as far as that, and then the process that it took to make it happen.
Well, from my standpoint, it started a few legislative sessions ago. In fact, what I'll share is initially one of the legislative sessions, I was up in Carson City. At that time, we were only talking about getting a new stadium for UNLV. Mm. And at that time, I can tell you that we definitely had no idea that we'd end up where we are right now. But things evolved from that point to a discussion about a joint use stadium. Along the way, I have to give Mr. Sheldon Adelson and the Sands Corporation credit for doing some initial exploration, design work, and pre-development work. And that got things moving. And then things took on a life of their own to get us where we are now. Another key element, and this is where I ran into Melissa at a meeting, is they have the Southern Nevada Tourism Infrastructure Committee. They were having meetings all along to figure out, okay, can we do this or not? Can it be joint use, and how are we going to finance it? And I was happy Melissa came to that meeting to get some firsthand information, but it evolved from that point. And again, it took on a life of its own to get us to where we are today.
Well, and that's why it kind of started as a rumor.
Right,
like,
it did.
You know,
that's
oh my God,
like,
the Raiders are going to come to Vegas? No way. And like, yeah, right, no way. And I remember seeing Ken had posted something about it, and I was like, you know what? I think I'm going to go check this out. I don't think people realize here in Las Vegas is that these things are open to the public.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And you're able just to walk in there and sit down and kind of get an idea of what's going on, shake some hands, maybe talk a little bit. It was eye-opening to see how much really goes into the planning part. And this was just the beginning stages. I wasn't able to make it to the ones that were after that. But that was like the first of many.
Yep. And that's the thing I hope people appreciate is to get to where we are right now. This started with meetings that occurred anywhere from 3, 4, 5 years ago. So it's a process and a journey. And naturally, as you're making your way through the journey, there's some people that are negative. There's some people that are speculating. But probably the best thing to do is to come to these public meetings and get the information firsthand.
Right.
In fact, I'm going to mention this. I'm sure we have some people in the audience that may be interested in being vendors, operators, or concessions at the new stadium. There's a very key meeting going on tomorrow afternoon, 4 p.m.
Wait,
sorry.
No.
I just wanted to make sure people like really hear it.
Yep. No.
Oh, we were going to reiterate it. Say that again.
There's a meeting tomorrow. It's called the Community Benefits Plan Oversight Committee meeting, but it's tomorrow 4 p.m. at the RTC building downtown, room 268. It's on the Las Vegas Stadium Authority Board website, but the idea behind tomorrow's meeting at 4 p.m. is we will have representatives from ASN Global, which is the master operator, and then we'll have representatives from Levy Restaurants, which will be the master concessionaire. They'll just be there to kind of initially introduce themselves and give people an idea how they're going to move forward as far as transitioning from the construction to the operations of the stadium.
Wow.
And to your point, Melissa, it's important that we go to public meetings like that so you get firsthand information versus spreading rumors.
Right. Like the retractable roof. I'm not sure
where you got the retractable roof.
It's because there's that retractable window or something,
and
right?
I don't know.
Okay, you're right on point with that. In fact, that's going to be unique and a great thing for people to see. There will be some retractable doors in the northern elevation of the building so that you'll be able to open those doors. And during a game or another event, you will see a great view of the strip.
Of the strip, yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Maybe not like in August, September, because it'll still be blazing hot here. But, you know, it'll be perfect come September, October.
Yes.
Great into the fall.
Yep.
Oh, that's amazing.
Football season.
Yeah. Are there any necessarily qualifications for the concessions? Is it small businesses that can participate in this, or is it open to anybody?
There's actually a small business component to what will be done. In fact, they're trying to get small, diverse businesses to participate in both the concessions and the operations. And one thing that I want to commend the Raiders organization on, as well as Mortensen McCarthy, who's building the stadium, they've done a very good job of making sure that small, diverse businesses could participate in the construction here to date. In fact, they've not only met the goals and metrics, they far exceeded them.
Excellent.
Wow.
So we just want to see that continue during the concessions and the operations of
the stadium. Well, let's hope so, because the fan base, let's be real, is very diverse. Like,
yes,
it's very culturally diverse.
Yes,
so, I mean, I think that's behind the Raiders. That's part of our culture.
It's definitely part of the attraction. It's definitely part of the culture. And the Raiders are committed to that, which is a good thing. In fact, starting from the owner on down, I know from a distance and just some limited talks and interactions, it's important to the owner, Mark Davis. Mm-hmm. Definitely important to the president, current president, Mark Bonet.
Man, that is just... shout out to Chase Corbin. I'm just going to put his name out there on blast. Philly Freeze Me. This is your opportunity to possibly, if you wanted to franchise one other local business that you have already, another location going into Raider Stadium, possibly. Any of the, I mean, this is, I would have never have known this.
Go ahead.
Yeah, what I was going to say, what I would encourage people to do is to come to the meeting, or if you can't come to the meeting, at least contact them. Learn about the requirements. You may find out that due to the magnitude and the capacity you need, you're unable, or you make the business decision not to move forward. But the best thing you can do is come get the information or follow up to get the information.
Absolutely.
And so at least you had an opportunity.
Yeah. And I mean, not only are you associated with that, but you're also it ties into your association with the Urban Chamber of Commerce.
That's correct.
Yeah. So
that's correct.
Not only are you providing knowledge on that side of the stadium authority, but also with Urban Chamber of Commerce. So talk about that a little bit. You serving as president, what options do people have in the city to get with you, meet with you, and...
We're fortunately at the Urban Chamber of Commerce. I've been there about 6.5 years now. We have our own building. So we have a business incubator, 1951 Stella Lake, just as a landmark. If you know where the McDonald's is on Lake Mead and Martin Luther King.
I know
King,
where Grits is.
Grits Cafe.
Hey, there you go. See, that's the one I should have used.
Use Grits.
Especially
shout
as much
Trina.
As I'm in Grits.
Right. Well, I love my Grit Bowl. Let's just be real.
Yep.
But yeah, shout out to Trina.
Yeah, there's a few things on the menu that I like. The Grits Bowl, catfish.
Yeah.
In fact,
it's all good.
Let me stay focused.
Right, right.
But yes, we're right down the street from Grits Cafe on Stella Lake. But again, we have our own business incubator, plus we have a business resource center. And we are a small business chamber. I mean, I'll tell you, we are focused on helping small, diverse businesses get started. Or, for example, if you're someone that has a business idea and you're not sure if it's going to work or not, or if it's viable, we have resources there to help you evaluate the idea.
Mm, so, excellent.
Great resource in the community.
Yeah, it is. So a couple questions that and maybe you don't know the answer, and that's okay.
It's all good.
Because my main concern that ever since they started building this, and I think I've talked to you about it before, is the lack of space for parking and or tailgating, which as football fans, as sport fans, we all know
yeah,
is
an issue.
Huge. So is there any plan? Because, I mean, it's a kind of an industrial area over there.
Yes, it is.
Of some sorts.
Yes,
is there any plans to try and like maneuver some of those places, people, businesses around to help allow this?
Yes, there will be provisions made for on-site tailgating, as well as the other thing that's in the works right now is a parking plan that is going to incorporate several satellite locations. And again, all this information is or will be public. So if you come to the Stadium Authority Board meetings, over the course of time, the Raiders are going to talk about their parking plan and how it will be rolled out. Right now, it's in negotiation and coordination with Clark County because they're overall responsible for things like that. But here's what I would say. those satellite parking locations are going to be an opportunity for tailgating, but they're also going to be a business opportunity as well, because they'll need different types of services to make them work.
What was the reason behind the not having the parking? Was that just a...
That was a design decision. From what I could tell, they looked at other new stadiums and how they were constructed and how they were laid out, and they decided that this is the design they wanted to go with for this particular location. And so, yes, they knew parking was going to be a challenge, but they also knew that by distributing the spaces that they need in the surrounding area, not too far from the stadium, in addition to that, I know that ride share is going to be a very big deal. Mm-hmm. They've actually worked the use of Uber and Lyft into the design of the stadium, so they'll be encouraging people to use those modes to get to and from. In addition to that, no secret that if you go on the other side of the freeway, you've got several resort locations there, and they anticipate that some individuals will stay in those locations and walk over Hacienda to get to the stadium on game day.
Excellent. What about... I've heard there's been rumors, because we know you hear rumors, about there being some kind of walkway being built to connect like Mandalay and the stadium, or somewhere in those, in that area, being connected to basically have a fan, like a walkway over.
The only thing that I've concretely seen discussed and anticipate being discussed is Hacienda. Maybe closing off part or all of Hacienda, so that on game day, people can walk over from the resort corridor. But again, the best thing is to follow what we do, because over the course of time, it'll all be revealed in public meetings.
And I'm going to hold you responsible to share some of those like meeting dates or times with us.
I think everybody should just favorite the page of the Las Vegas Stadium Authority. Just favorite on your tab and just keep checking in for sure.
Twitter and stuff.
I agree with that. The website or the URL is lvstadiumauthority.com. That's lvstadiumauthority.com. And I just encourage people, especially people that have a business interest, visit that website on a regular basis. And, you know, my definition of regular is maybe every 3 to 5 business days.
Yeah. And those of you in the chat, I did type in the website address. So click on it. Make sure that you, you know, just... follow that,
because we're required by law to notice when we're going to be having public meetings, so you'll always know by going to that website the next meeting that we have coming up. Plus, in addition to that, we post the past meeting agendas and minutes and attachments.
Awesome. So what got you started as far as joining that board for the Las Vegas Stadium Authority? Were you, was it an invitation? Was it something that you directly contacted?
I applied. In fact, I just was renewed by the Clark County Commission, so I want to thank all of them. In particular, I want to thank Commissioner Lawrence Weekly for you know, leading the effort to initially get me placed on the board, as well as being behind the scenes to help make sure that I was reappointed. But I'll be on the board through December 2022, which I really like, because that enables me to serve on the board while we transition from construction to the ongoing operations of the stadium. But where it all started is a little bit about my background. I'm a retired Air Force Lieutenant Colonel. I'm a civil engineer out of the Air Force Academy. I've got 25 plus years doing project management, construction management. In addition to that, I've got a little bit of a finance background.
Because you have an MBA.
Along the way. Yes, I do.
Shout out to the hard work.
Yeah, I do. I put that time in grad school. In addition to that, all along the way, I'm from LA originally and then Sacramento. My mother raised three boys. My father was never in the picture. So I'm one of those challenged socioeconomic demographics. But my mom stressed education and excellence. To that end, I'm an engineer. My twin brother's an engineer. And then my younger brother's an engineer. But at the same time, I never lost sight of where I came from. So I've always wanted to make sure that I'm turning around and helping other individuals, especially young brothers that come from backgrounds like mine. So that kept me engaged in the community. So when you look at my professional background, a little bit of my finance background and real estate development background, and then finally my community engagement, it put me in a good position to be qualified to sit on the board right
now.
Oh,
absolutely. I think more than qualified. It should have been just a given.
A given. Here, yeah. Take it. That's yours.
Y'all. I'm going to be humble about it. I'm going to be humble about it.
Well,
it's a blessing. Yeah, it's definitely a blessing.
And I'm happy that you are going to be there in that extended period so that you are, like you said, in that transition. Because this is all one thing for us here to be super excited about it. Right. You know, the new stadium.
I mean,
I know when I first went to the Niner Stadium after they first opened. And I won't even comment about the Niners, but what I found that was an issue initially was all the Lyft rideshare problems.
Right.
And it was so hard. You literally had to walk like a mile away from the stadium just to catch a ride.
Right.
And so it's, I mean, I just, you know, it's interesting to be able to know how to get through those challenges initially.
The one thing I'll comment on that too is, and to their credit, the Raiders have been very transparent and proactive about this, is they know that other stadiums have had some challenges. They know that we're going to have some challenges to work through here in terms of the inflow of traffic before games and then, you know, the outflow after the game. In fact, things will probably be even more concentrated after a game, because you figure before a game people be coming in at different times, but after the game it's
all
like everybody
time.
Wants to leave
yeah.
at the same
right.
time. But again, the Raiders have been very proactive, and what I know will happen based on what they've suggested is that we may have to evolve our transportation plan over the course of time and our parking plan over the course of time. So what I would ask people to do is to be patient early on and give them a chance to work things out. Anybody that's been here knows that when T-Mobile first opened, they had some challenges.
Oh, yeah.
But I would venture to say by now they've worked a lot of those challenges out. Same thing will hold true with the stadium.
Well, that'll be the other thing, too, is when there happens to be a Raiders game and a Golden Knights game. You know, and you figure how that's going to work. And even though they are on two separate sides of the freeway, it's still all that traffic kind of congregating into like a couple mile radius.
The good thing is that as traffic engineers or engineers, you can do some modeling to at least anticipate some of that. And then when it actually happens, actually document what happens and then come up with some solutions long term. So, yeah, there may be some friction here and there, but long term, again, I commend the Raiders for being very proactive and understanding that this is something that they're going to need to pay attention to.
Gotcha.
Now, I know you're a numbers guy, and I just want to ask really quickly, did they project, or do you have a projection as far as even partnering with Las Vegas Visitors Convention Center Authority, what the projection of attendance would be or the amount of visitors at the time of the opening of the arena all the way through the season?
I know the capacity for the stadium is about 65,000.
Okay.
And they do anticipate that a good number of the people that come to the games will be coming from out of town.
Right.
So I'm sure that I don't know the exact numbers, but I can definitely suggest to you that a decent amount of the people coming to the stadium will be from out of town. In fact, the premium seat licenses that people were paying, they just mentioned the fact, I want to say it's 20% to 30%. Of those licenses that were sold went to people from out of town.
Oh, I believe it.
So we already know. And if you look at the Raider Nation, for example,
we're deep.
We're deep and we travel well.
And we're from all over.
Yes.
Yeah. And internationally, too. Let's not forget. We got our brothers and sisters in Mexico and in the London area. Yep. So we're all over. Yeah. Yep.
And now the one set of numbers that I would like to throw out there is, first of all, in order for the stadium to work from a business standpoint, we're looking at having 45 plus events in a, you know, as a part of the, not just football, we need to have 45 plus events each year to make it work. And then in addition to that, what I want people to focus on is there will be anywhere from $12 to $15 billion of economic activity over the 30-year life of the stadium. So it's not just about the $2 billion nearly going into the construction. There's another $12 to $15 billion over the course of the 30-year life of the stadium. So those, It's a great economic development opportunity for the community.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Man. I mean,
I'm just excited.
I am, too.
So do we, I mean, are we set?
First of all,
is it
I'm
ready
bad.
To go? Like, is it going to be ready to go
the
countdown?
Here's my story, and I'm sticking to it. The stadium will be ready, July 31st, 2020.
That's what they say. It looks like everything is on according to plan.
Yeah, I just, you know, I want to ask.
I'm just here
because I don't know anybody else. So, you know, LA started their stadium before we did. And I feel like they're like five years behind us already.
I'm familiar with their story a little bit, yes.
Do you? Because I'm curious. I just wonder, like, I mean, I know that they don't have as much of a rush because their teams are currently in other places to play, whereas the Raiders don't really have anymore. So they're in more of a time crunch. Is that the only reason? Because I feel like they're just, or maybe it's just LA time. Like, it's just, we'll get to when we get to it.
I don't know. It's a weird looking facility.
I'm not going to comment
you
know, on
that. Remember that movie that had like the spaceship that was kind of like that weird.
It's almost
shape.
A Star Trek-ish kind of thing. I don't
E.T.?
Know.
No, it was like, it was something
maybe
similar.
Battlestar Galactica. But I'm mad at how she threw a jab at your stadium there, Quan, for a second. Like, I don't care about the 49ers.
I didn't, listen, I didn't even mention how much I didn't like the stadium. It was the way that they didn't have things going very well.
All I know is the Raiders beat them in their stadium a couple of years ago, and that was our Super Bowl.
Yeah, for sure.
I see some frowns around the table, so I may have struck
a
nerve.
He's happy. He just ate. He's sitting here eating while we're just like,
So looking at the upcoming schedule, what game are you anticipating the most, aside from all of them? Like, I'm looking forward to all the home games. What game is sticking out to you as far as our...
I'm sure the Raiders-Chiefs game will be pretty interesting.
Yes,
especially,
for sure.
You know, shouts out, and boy, this is hard for me to do, but shouts out and props to the Chiefs for winning the Super Bowl.
Oh, I know.
And in particular, Pat Mahomes.
Yeah, it's AFC West.
As well as Eric Bieniemy, I think he's the offensive coordinator, who also happens to be a member of Omega Psi Phi fraternity. So
there you go. Shout him out.
Fraternity brothers. So.
Yes. Oh, okay.
Yep.
Shout out to those Qs.
So, exactly. But again, congratulations to the Chiefs. So I'm sure that's going to be an interesting game this year.
It is. How did you feel about that? Because I was torn. I was kind of like, San Francisco's on the other side of the Bay, and I know we're no longer the Bay. Yeah. But then again, the Chiefs are in that AFC West division with us. And we felt that pain before with Denver Broncos, having Peyton Manning. We knew our whole season was in the can. But how did you feel? Who were you going for in that Super Bowl?
I think I'll say my lunch money was with the Chiefs, but then I have a twin brother who's a big time 49er fan. In fact, there's somebody out there, Thomas Mason. I don't know if he's in the atmosphere.
T
Mace, he had to he purposely watched the game by himself, and I'm sure he's glad he did now.
Oh yeah, because if I would have been over there,
he already lost because
I beat the fantasy team.
That's
so
right.
They already mad.
I saw that on social media.
But he would have been a little extra mad. I didn't want to go lay into him too hard. I know he's got the family to, you know, keep up, and they're busy with the kids and sports. So I didn't want to go too hard on your teammates. Plus, he got a big birthday coming up this year.
That's right. He's going to be the big 5-0 this year.
Oh,
welcome
yeah.
to my club.
That's a good club to be in. Look at your resume. It speaks for itself. It's a great
club.
No,
I'm pretty blessed. I'll turn 57 this year, so life is good.
Well,
it
does
you
well.
I would never guess that.
Never.
No.
Thank you. That's the reason why I throw it out there.
I look good.
My three more years, I'll look like this at age 60. That's the goal.
Hey, I think that's an attainable goal for sure. Okay. So is there anything else out of community work that you're working with? I know you were saying that you would like all the young brothers and sisters to kind of up and come and kind of teach them the way of starting small businesses, teaching them about financing. What else do you have in the works that you're working on?
Well, at the Urban Chamber of Commerce, we just brought on 6 new board members. And what we're really happy about, and I'll give part of the credit to the person who helps me co-lead what goes on at the chamber, Shondell Newsom, with some new marketing. But one of the things, out of the 6 new board members we brought aboard, 4 of the 6 are millennials.
We are
intentionally making sure that we bring
it
on
the
next generation, a younger generation, fresh ideas, fresh energy, and basically they'll be responsible for taking the Urban Chamber to the next level.
Yeah, very good.
So that's something that will be going on. Let's face it, individuals like me, our job is to get things to a certain point and then pass
that's
the torch
baton.
And the baton to the next generation.
Very cool. Well, again, guys, you're tuned in to Girl Chat Sports with Mo, Mel, Quan, and Ken.
Hey,
the number again is 702-608-3259. Any questions you have, definitely join in the chat or give us a call. We are having an awesome, awesome education right now with Mr. Ken Evans. He's enlightened me on so much. I think my biggest takeaway is the fact that you're a face of diversity within the board members of Las Vegas Stadium Authority. And the fact that Raiders are very encouraging for that diversity.
Yes, they are.
And the fact also that you're giving open forums to business opportunities as far as concessions within the stadium. Is there any other special things in the stadium that we can look forward to? Any other special things that they said that maybe unique from others?
Isn't there a torch or something in there?
Yeah, yes,
owl.
There is. Yes, there is.
Oh,
there's gonna,
what are you
there's
talking
gonna,
about?
There's going to be a tribute to
for Al
the
Davis.
Original founder.
Yeah, we have that.
Okay, yeah.
With
yeah.
Al Davis. They have that outside of Alameda. So they're bringing that. Is that going to be indoors or outside of the Allegiant?
I want to say it's going to be built indoors within the stadium, and it's going to use a unique technology to
I think the pictures, it was like right there near those opening doors
yes.
or something.
Wow.
Yes. I can tell you, when you look at the suites, the way it's built, it's going to be designed to do a lot of things. If you've ever been to the Superdome, for example,
You
know how they have those side rooms and side areas that are kind of like a nightclub
for
smaller events. I anticipate this stadium will incorporate some of those same
That'll
types
be good
of
because when they
too.
Have Essence Festival, you know, they have the super lounges, the ultra lounges. So that was in the Superdome, and you go to the little lounge. And it was a big enough space where you had room to see the artists and all that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I see a future of Super Bowl projections coming here.
Yes. That, you know, naturally, a few shouts out to my colleague, Mary Beth Seawald, over at the Vegas Chamber. They did a preview Las Vegas a few weeks ago. They had Commissioner Goodell here, and naturally that was one of the things that he was asked was about the Super Bowl. And I'm sure, you know, the way people are working behind the scenes, the Super Bowl will be on the menu in the not too distant future.
Man, and we already have draft lined up. So what is your take as far as that goes? Because I remember watching the live on the city planning of them meeting with the county commissioners.
That's going to be a great opportunity, as well as a bit of a dress rehearsal or a trial run for possibly a future Super Bowl. April 25th through 27th, the draft will be in town. That'll be another big thing. In fact, if I remember the numbers correctly, I think they had about 600,000 people or 200,000 per day in Nashville. They're anticipating we're going to surpass that here in Las Vegas.
Oh, I believe it. Yeah.
If you watch the recent LVCVA meeting, I know they approved quite a bit of things, resources and logistics for that. But it's going to be a big deal. And getting back to my area with the Urban Chamber, one of the things that we participated in was a program called NFL Business Cadet Connect. And what that's designed to do is to get small, diverse businesses to be vendors, contractors, subcontractors, suppliers during the NFL draft. And that's in process right now. We anticipate there's going to be a NFL Business Cadet directory that will come out. Hopefully some of our chamber members will be in that directory. And beyond that, the bottom line is hopefully some of them will get some contracts and we'll have some success stories. So again, another great opportunity for the area.
I would have never thought this growing up here, being born and raised, that our city would flourish as it has. I mean, I understand the population and because of the housing market, but I just never would have thought what that growth brought.
And I think the city's going to continue to grow. In fact, I'll tell you, when I came here 30 plus years ago, I was an active duty Air Force captain up at a remote classified location. And when it came time for me to rotate out 2 years into my assignment, I said, wait a minute. I see how this valley is growing, how the city's growing. I'm a civil engineer. I want to stay here. And here I am about 30 years later. And to your point, the city continues to grow. If you look at 215, for example, you know, I was talking to Melissa about this. One of the committees I sit on, it's called the Transportation Resource Advisory Committee or the TRAC Committee. When you look at 215, that will be 5 lanes, both sides, or a total of 10 lanes before it's done, all around the perimeter, the loop of the valley.
That's crazy.
So if you've been to Atlanta, now, unfortunately, they always are working on theirs.
Yeah. And their freeway is weird.
I'm sure we will be,
to
too.
Left. Did you see that where they have an exit? I can't remember which freeway it is, but they have an exit to the left.
Well, that's like
right
over here on Charleston on the 15th.
Oh, yeah, that new one. Yeah, to the left. That's crazy.
Yeah, that was pretty unique, too, but it's working.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is our valley is going to continue to grow. And what I encourage people to do is don't fight the growth. Get in where you fit in, especially if you're a business owner, an entrepreneur. Figure out a way to get involved, start a business, grow a business, and ride the curve, because the valley is going to continue to grow. They're talking about having, I want to say, 3 to 4 million people here before we're done.
I believe that. I totally believe that. And then it's going to look at prospects for NBA talk of getting a team here, possibly. Yep. Major League Baseball team has already been talks.
Yeah. I've heard some rumors.
MLS was in some talks. So, yeah, I definitely see that.
To me, it's all a part of the city growing up and taking on its own corporate identity, but community identity on top of it. So, again, I wouldn't fight it. I'd figure out how you can participate.
And well, it looks like there's room for growth for that. There's room for opportunity, especially for the SBA, you know, or a small business.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it is. Yeah. Yes, it is.
I just found it, you know, coming from Seattle, I guess you take for granted what you already have. So coming here and you're like, oh, you didn't really have it. I mean, it hurt when I was here to not have sports live here like that. But seeing how people that are locals or that are here, people that are avid sports fans, like I'm excited over just because I'm a sports fan. Yes. I don't care about the teams that are here as long as there are teams here. So to have like, you know, to come from a place where I grew up with it to now people are starting to get it and they're like maybe in an adult age or now there's kids that are able to grow up with it too now here. It's pretty exciting.
It sure is because, for example, it's not just about the Raiders. It's also about like the Las Vegas Aces are here. I've gone to a couple. In fact, I was fortunate. My first game was their playoff game, and man, that was a great experience. So I hope that people will go out, continue to support the Aces. In addition to that, you have the Aviators, the AAA baseball team.
Yes.
Real nice stadium.
And that ballpark.
Yep. Great, great ballpark. So the point is, all these things are bringing a side to Vegas that wasn't there before, but it's going to help us grow. And then what I also hope will happen is that we'll continue to expand and diversify our economy, like healthcare, for example. Mm-hmm. You know, I hope that we'll continue to expand that to meet the fact that more and more people are going to move here.
Right. Yeah. Well, speaking of those local sports teams, we should plug a few things that have been happening here locally, like our Las Vegas Aces. There's been a little bit of movement in the WNBA.
We acquired a player, too.
Exactly. We acquired a player. So we've got Angel McCautry, mm-hmm. I think is how you pronounce it. She was the number one pick back in 2009. We have now four first-round picks. That hasn't happened since the Seattle Storm had it happen, I think, back in like 2009 or something, or 11.
Bring it, girls.
And she's been with the Dream for the last, since her time. And I'm excited.
I just say bring it.
Let's make it.
So we may get a championship.
Yeah, that's what I'm that's right. What I didn't want to say it. I didn't want to say it, but that
girl
that
power
bring it,
all
I want
over
it.
To
it. Be, I want to see it.
I'm not, good with that.
Not to
I'm
mention, our girls are playing overseas right now and they all had Olympic qualifiers. So Asia Wilson, Kelsey Plum, they're with Team USA. They led them, have now, they made the qualifying for the Tokyo Olympics. Liz Cambage for Australia, she helped them. She had like 28 or 29 points for their last game. They have made it to the Olympic qualifiers. And even our young 22-year-old Jisoo Park, she has helped South Korea make it to their bid for the Tokyo Olympics. So
our ladies are out there doing it. It bodes
well
for the Aces.
It does. It does.
Very much so.
It does.
And I would just encourage people to come on out to the games because it is a great experience.
It is.
And we'll come out to some other games and make specifically because there's been some big moves in the WNBA as of today. So Skylar Diggins-Smith, who had been off for, I think, the year for having, she gave birth. Mm-hmm. She just got traded and picked up by the Phoenix Mercury. So she's now teamed up with Diana Taurasi as well as Brittany Grimer.
Wow. Okay. That's going to be an interesting matchup.
Right, and we play them, and we have a home game, I believe, with them start of the season, too, on the schedule. I think we play them in April, if I'm not mistaken. So that's going to be
well, our season starts in May.
I'm sorry, not April, but May. Yeah, I think it's in that month, or if not, a little bit later.
I know we played our first game is against the Wings, so that's May 17th. But I know eventually, I'm sure, obviously,
No, the Mercury's coming. That's going to be a good draw. That should just bring everyone out. And can I tell you, Mark Davis is a huge fan of the Aces. He sits courtside every home game.
White polo out.
And it's like all white. Yeah. Yeah.
Guy does not mess around. That's outstanding. And that was good to see, too, is the fact that the Raiders have come in and individuals starting with the owner have made it a point to interact with the community plus support some of the other community sports teams.
Well,
that's great
and giving they were giving back all the tickets to the youth that were doing different contests. And
I mean, they've donated money to schools. They've had players show up at schools. Yes. They've done a lot of good community work to get them their selves known out here.
Yes, and that's one thing that I anticipate that they will continue to do, and that's a big part of their corporate culture is to make sure that there's community engagement. Yes, you know, I'll mention the fact that there's a community benefits plan, but from what I've seen that's been great is you really don't need to, quote unquote, hold that over. No, the Raiders do things like that anyway. That's
right.
Part of their culture.
Right.
So I just see things continuing to happen like that in our community, and it's a great thing.
I think so. And we're always viewed as the outlaws. We're always looked at as the bad guys. You know, I've had people even ask, are Raider fans dangerous? I'm like, what?
You should look at them and say, hey, I'm a Raiders
right.
fan. Do,
like,
I look dangerous?
Do I look dangerous?
Bo's real
like,
dangerous.
Come on. Yeah.
Careful
like, come
now.
On. Like, what, I'm what?
Real dangerous.
Not even. I'm very nice. Very nice.
There
angelic. Yes.
There we go.
Mm-hmm. So, Ken, are you familiar with XFL? Because they just started that last weekend. Have
just,
you got
just
into
a little
that
bit. Admittedly, I didn't watch any of the games. I watched a little bit of the highlights. Now, in the past, I've watched a couple of the games, but I didn't catch this opening round.
That's okay, because we've got about nine more weeks
mm-hmm.
to go.
So
and it was
I'm
good.
Sure I'll
it's
watch
actually
it.
Pretty good.
I will say this, though. From what I saw on social media, people were pleased with the product. And they thought it was a good
people
quality
were talking
product.
About it.
So that was a good
yeah.
thing.
Yeah.
That was a good thing.
They said on average there was like 3.4 some million viewers for throughout the weekend.
Right.
So there was two games on Saturday, two games on Sunday. They're on major networks like ABC, Fox.
Right. And that's the other thing that I was paying attention to is from a business standpoint, because if you don't have that business backing, despite your best desires and efforts, things won't last in our society. But you know, to see that they do have the backing of the major networks and some of the other key individuals mm-hmm. should be around for a while.
Yeah.
Well, and also watching just I was watching the games, but I didn't necessarily take part in, like, you know, trying to find people's names and numbers, but the actual stadiums and the attendance mm-hmm. compared to like the Alliance, which we had a little while, you know, last year, which kind of fell through. People were out in the stadiums. They were out there. I mean, it was.
I mean,
was impressed.
It looked like
I was
it
impressed.
Was a good turnout. And even for us,
good
too,
turnout.
Spectators were just
yeah.
in it.
Mm-hmm. I think what we're finding is that football is still the king sport
oh, yeah.
in America.
Yeah.
There's a lot of demand for it. And the XFL hopefully is going to fulfill some of that demand during a time when people are kind of
not watching the NFL
yeah.
or messing
yeah.
with the NFL
yeah.
is that alternative to
yeah.
watch something else. And that's what I was telling Mel earlier today. I said, if the ticket prices go high, it's because it's a demand of people that don't watch during regular season NFL.
It'll be good.
Yeah.
I'm excited this
I'm sorry
weekend.
Your Seattle
yeah,
team Seattle, lost.
We didn't do good. But we did have a guy that did make the very first touchdown of the XFL because, of course, we were the first game being played. But he was it. Not It wasn't like the DC defender team. So that's. That's good. I'm excited because it'll be their first home game this weekend. They get to play in CenturyLink. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
I'm excited for that. I want to see kind of how Seattle's fans come out because currently, you know, we don't have any basketball team to go watch currently at this time. So that's
yeah,
our sport right now.
Yeah, I think I caught one of the last Supersonic games way back when, and I'll just leave that alone.
That's okay. That's all right.
It's probably
that's
still right. a little bit of a sore point.
I mean, you know. It's a sore point for a lot of Seattle, but they'll be in CenturyLink again, like because there's not any other. I mean, there's no baseball right now.
Yeah.
You know, spring training's coming up, but it won't
yep.
be in Seattle, of course. I'm excited to see kind of the turnout because you know Seattle's fan base is you know they go behind the Sounders.
Well,
y'all
they get go
behind
hard. The
Huskies,
yeah,
they
I was
behind
say they
everybody.
Go, yeah, I was about to say for the Sounder games, they showed up and showed out.
My
twin brother lives up there, and
okay.
yeah, he's. Become a little bit of a Seattle fan, more so his sons. And then
yeah.
I got a couple other online social media friends.
Sure.
Man, they're all over Seattle.
Oh, yeah.
And then naturally, there's Melissa.
Hey, you know, I mean.
She's the only Seattle person I know that goes hard for Seattle. I mean, I know a few other people that I've worked with in the past, and I thought, oh, my God, they're so annoying with the Seahawks thing. But she is the one that goes in deep. And it's
almost
like I'm almost to the point, but I love her dearly, to move back. Just move back.
No, because that traffic, that rain, I can't do it. Like, people know.
Oh, yeah,
the
weather.
Weather is just
when
an issue.
When it rains here, like,
yeah.
first of all, it rained all of January except for one day.
Yep.
All. And you know how January feels like it's 5 years long? Could you imagine that with rain? Except for one
no,
day.
No, it's depressing.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't
yep.
I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
I couldn't do it. I'm
and the traffic
a
is, I think it's worse than Atlanta. Because at least Atlanta has a few more different
right.
freeways.
Right.
Seattle has
one
a
big
freeway.
Long stretch.
Yeah.
I-5, I think.
Yeah. It's great. It's insane. And part of that freeway is still only like two or three lanes. There's no way they're ever going to extend it.
Yeah.
But
Yeah, that weather is there's an Air Force base up there, McCord. And yeah, we used to go there from time to time. And yeah, that weather is no. That's okay.
You're like, no.
I like Vegas.
Yeah. I'm glad you like my home. And
you have some breaking news because both, you know, Alicia Gibbs is watching. Shout out to Alicia.
Hey, Alicia.
I didn't know either. You had a twin brother. I had no idea. She was like, you have a twin kid?
Yes, I have a twin brother.
You're going to have to post some pictures so we can
I didn't know
it.
That
Actually,
either.
I have. He visited Vegas a couple of summers ago, and I'll make sure I post that picture, and I'm sure
we
y'all hold me
it.
To it. But
yes.
He came here. He had my two nephews, Ryan and Aiden, with him, and that was a big deal. Everybody was like, does he look like you?
Right. I want to see. Yeah. Are you identical?
No, nah, fraternal.
But sometimes fraternals look. My dad and my uncle were a fraternal. And they looked identical.
I'll say this: the one time we did look alike is he went to the Air Force Academy with me after high school, and when we had the shaved heads and what we call the birth control military glasses, we looked a lot alike then. Although he was heavier than me, but yeah, we did a little. But we're fraternal.
Okay. All right.
Ken, where can they find you as far as on any social media or anything like that that you have? I know you have the Urban Chamber of Commerce.
Yes.
Social media. Instagram.
Yes. I'll give both the Urban Chamber and then for those that may be interested, my personal. But for the Urban Chamber, we're on Twitter at Urban Chamber. We're on Facebook, Urban Chamber of Commerce dash Nevada. And then we're on the gram, I think is what the young
the gram.
Folks call
the gram.
The gram.
Yes.
We're on the gram. Mm-hmm. Now, shouts out to Daphne Moore for getting us to do that from Moore Marketing Agency a few months ago, because that's helped our exposure quite a bit. But
yeah.
We're Urban Chamber of Commerce on Instagram. And then for me personally, on Twitter, at Ken Evans 585. I'm on Instagram as well, Ken Evans 585. See, typical engineer, boring, gonna do it the same way.
Oh,
and
no.
Then Ken Evans on Facebook.
It makes it easier that
it
way.
Sure
way.
You probably have the same login password for all your emails too, don't you?
I'm not gonna address
don't
that.
Get that up. You don't have to disclose it, but I'm like, I'm one of the ones that have the same one going because I can't remember all this stuff. You know, it's gate codes, it's passwords.
You know what?
This,
I will say
that.
I have a system, and I'll leave it at that.
Okay, sounds good.
Yep. But yeah, I am on social media and the Urban Chambers on social media. And I would encourage people, whether you're on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, please follow us because we make it a point to put the programs, the activities that we're doing very quickly. We do Capital Connections. So if you need money for your business, find out more about Capital Connections. And then if you need to be connected to contract opportunities, get more information about Contract Connections. Bottom line is we want to help you grow your business at the Urban Chamber.
Or develop one.
Yes, that is very true.
And that's where I'm like in the side of like develop.
Yeah,
love it.
Yeah, and in fact, that's one thing I'll say is with our business incubator and our business resource center, which together make up the business success center, to us, we think it is a success if you come in, you evaluate your idea, and you make the business decision that either A, it's not a viable idea, or B, the timing or the resources aren't right. That's a better way to go than putting time, effort, sweat into something and getting a year or more into it and figuring out, you know what, shouldn't have made this business decision. So again, even if you're thinking about doing it or have an idea, come to the Urban Chamber. We have individuals that can help you vet the idea.
I'm there.
Hey, we look forward to having you come by the Urban Chamber.
I'm coming by. I'm coming by.
She's going to be there with bells
on. I'm coming by.
Right?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness.
So we do a segment called Girl Power.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm good with that.
And then we do a Coug'd It moment, too.
Yeah.
So which one do you want to do first?
A Coug'd It.
So tell the background on that, Mel.
I'm a Husky, University of Washington. Our rival is the Washington State Cougars.
Cougars,
and they're notorious for... basically winning something and in one split second they've Coug'd it and lost.
Oh, okay.
So it's kind of like those people that are out there that basically have screwed up.
So they know how to snatch. What's that saying? They know how to snatch defeat from the jaws of
exactly.
That's basically it.
Yes.
This week's Coug'd It moment will go to the referees. I don't know if you watched the Blazers and the Jazz game last Friday, where Damian Lillard had shot a 3-pointer, tied the game. I think Utah went back and hit a 2, and 13 seconds left has a layup. It's clear goaltending, which could have tied the game.
They didn't call it.
Yeah, of course. And of course, the refs afterward, you know, Damian, he's hot.
And they're in Utah. This is what happens in Utah.
Home team call.
Home team call. That's what happens. And I have another XFL Coug'd moment. Okay. Marquette King did an amazing punt.
Yes.
Punt return.
He still has it.
Yes, still has it. 31 years old, still got it. Mm-hmm. Maybe get looked at and picked up. Who knows? You never know. But anyway, one of his players decided that he should get the ball on the punt return,
touch the ball.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. Huge. Ooh.
Maybe it's
moment.
Still like those butterflies. You know,
I don't know.
First
the commentators went
back.
In because they were like, what is he doing?
I hope he at least held on to the ball.
Nope.
It was a touch and it kept.
Into the end zone.
Yep.
Yeah, we'll leave that alone.
Yep.
Not so much.
And as a part of our series of Black History Month, not only are we having Ken featured, of course, but I wanted to shout out how we have a new first Black female coach in the NFL.
Yes.
Did you hear about that?
Oh, no, I didn't hear about that.
Jennifer King. Mm-hmm. Jennifer King. She will be the assistant coach for the Washington Redskins.
Oh, outstanding.
You know what's funny? I read a few articles. They no longer even mention Redskins. They say the Washington team.
Yeah, okay. the Washington team. Because they're still on the nomenclature.
I mean, either pick one. Either you're going to pick a new name or you're not. It just felt weird. Like, because I feel like I'm talking about my Huskies. The Washington team, it just is. Anyway.
But we know what it is.
So she's the first full-time Black female coach, and she's an intern.
Yep. That is
Isn't it? Ron Rivière is the head coach for Washington now, and she used to also intern for him back then.
Okay. Yeah, but which is with Carolina, right?
Yeah, Carolina.
One of the Carolina Panthers. So it's just such a coup. It's like one of those things.
That's outstanding, and it also points out one thing we talk about at the Chamber is build relationships before you need them. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to borrow from what Shondell says, build real R-E-A-L relationships.
I love it.
Because to your point, she had that relationship before this situation, and when the opportunity presented itself, leveraged the relationship.
So, well, and don't burn your bridges either.
Yeah.
Because had something happen between them and now, look, he's got a new relationship with Washington. Correct. He's got a new head coach, and now she got an in.
Yeah, that's just as equally important because, you know, in the position that I am, sometimes you see individuals. It's okay to disagree with people. It's okay to get upset. But if you can still be civil and respectful, you don't burn bridges. So, good point.
Yeah.
Good point.
And you keep your integrity intact with that, too. You keep the same energy all the way through. If we can say one thing about Ken, it's going to be the same consistent answer with anybody that runs into you.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah.
Sometimes that gets me in trouble with some people. It's all good.
Let us know you're getting in trouble, Ken.
I doubt that. I highly doubt that. Maybe private troubles. I don't know. But
those Omega functions, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. That's what I'm thinking. Fraternity kind of stuff.
Oh, we're going to leave that alone.
Yeah, exactly.
All I'm going to say is catch us for Wine Soiree weekend.
Oh, yeah.
In the first weekend of August.
Okay.
I'll stop there.
It's always a good look there.
Yeah, it is.
Yes, it is.
It is. Well, Ken, again, it's been an honor and a pleasure of having
you
on the show. We really appreciate you taking the time. You dropped a lot of gems tonight, a lot of jewels. I hope everybody that tuned in, you can watch the replay.
Go ahead and share it.
And sharing is caring is also part of getting the wealth of knowledge that you need. I mean, if you didn't catch it now, you'll definitely catch it later.
My pleasure. I want to say thank you both.
You're welcome.
All right, y'all. We're out of here for Wednesdays. We'll see you next week.
See you next Wednesday, guys.